everyone. Thank you guys so much for joining us for this important conversation, and thank you to our panelists for joining us for this conversation. Tom, I'm going to start with you, partially because your book, Toxic Inequality, just came out, and because it is partially the name of this session. So can you talk to us about how you define toxic inequality? What is it? Why does it matter?
Thanks for the question, and thank you everybody for showing up for Aspen for making this possible. It's really great. I came up with the idea of toxic inequality because I think it's really important to distinguish the period of time we are in the United States versus the run-of-the-mill, ordinary, traditional inequality that we have always had in the United States. And for me, what distinguishes it is four or five things, and let me run through them very, very quickly here. First, we are at historic highs in terms of income and wealth inequality. So quick data point, 1% of the population owns about 42% of the wealth. The bottom 90%, there can't be a bottom 90. It's been declining in wealth over the past decade or two. Second, in the United States, we are in the midst of what I would call stalled mobility for families. It's much tougher for families to move up than it has been any time since World War II in the United States. The rungs in the ladder, how much more difficult it is to move up, have gotten further apart. Associated with that is the stagnated living standard for the majority of American families. That's a toxic mixture by itself right there. Right? It's tougher to get ahead, people are working harder to stay in place, and we're facing historic highs in income and wealth inequality. We throw into that matrix a couple of other important transitions. One is a widening racial wealth gap. The typical African-American family has about 8 cents in wealth for every dollar of wealth that the average or median white family has. And for Latino families, it's about 9.5 cents of wealth for every dollar of wealth that typical white family has. And that gap has been growing. We looked at data, and I talk about it in the book a little bit. We look at data over the last 27 years. The racial wealth gap just measured black versus white increased, widened 3 times in that 27-year period, looking at the same set of families. And then it's also important to understand or to think about the ethnic and racial demographic transition that we have been going through in the United States, most particularly around immigration, around birth rates and death rates. We're seeing a transition. Some of the demographers tell us that by about the year 2041, if nothing else happens, and a lot is happening perhaps to interrupt this, the United States will no longer see a majority of white people. People of color will be a numerical majority. And then lastly, to really make this convergence very toxic in my mind, we have seen an increase in the pandering that politicians do to explain the stagnant living standard, the stalled mobility, and the historic high levels of income and wealth inequality. And not just in this last election cycle where it got really ratcheted up, but we've been seeing that for the last couple of decades. So looking at that mixture, I try to understand that while that seems to implicate and affect everybody in the United States, nonetheless, it impacts different groups differently according to where you're situated by economics and by race and by ethnicity. And that's really important to keep in mind. So part of the research that I did for toxic inequality, we started interviewing, we talked to nearly 200 families, 185 families or so, in 1998, and followed them up 12 years later and re-interviewed them about 2010, 2011. First, when their children were about 5, they would have been about seniors in high school or so, to see what happened to their children's lives, to see what happened to their economic mobility, to see what happens with the transmission, to the extent there is, of advantage, of disadvantage, the reproduction of inequality in American society. And a couple of the top-level findings for me in the book, you know, just the elevator's only going to the second floor here, one of the top findings for me is listening to family stories over those 12 years and how much they really struggle and they sacrifice for their kids and themselves and they work a lot of jobs But they're tethered to an economy that bounces them up and down. And in spite of all that hard work, it is much too easy for a minor mishap to throw them off track, because they don't have the protection of financial wealth to buffet that family crisis or an axle breaking in the Washington, D.C. winter or something like that. Second high level understanding for me out of the interviews and a lot of data that I'm able to look at in the book that really puts this all together is that all the families that I talk to and the people we talk to around the country, they're stories, but they're data points. They're data points that make up the large landscape that, as a sociologist, I also look at the large patterns. And so what we see in the large patterns and the stories that tell us how it happens and why it happens, it's a story of inequality being passed along from generation to generation. And we see that over the 12 years in one generation. Other more nationally representative data tells us about that, the society as a whole. So that's where I would start.
So I think that's a great framework for where we're going next. Jose, I saw you nodding a little bit. I'm wondering, to what extent and in what ways is that framework that Tom talked about, how does that resonate in the communities that you work with in San Francisco and the Mission and with the families that you work with?
It does resonate a lot. And again, thank you for inviting me to be a part of this conversation. I think what I've gotten away from Tom's work, not just with the current book, but prior, is that it really is kind of painting a picture of life that's very complicated. And I think that's what I take away from it, because it's when you look at people's lives and what they're trying to do and how they're trying to navigate, you know, not just the financial systems, but really navigate, you know, our whole economy, it's actually really complicated. And I think as practitioners, we have to sort of embrace the complexity, you know, for what it is, without trying to simplify it in any way. Because once we do that, I think we kind of distort a lot of the complexity, the nuance, that is really important in understanding, you know, the sort of strategies that people employ. And so, I think, you know, but I think for us, you know, we kind of try to understand it in one way or try to put it in some one little box, you know, but I think, you know, it's a lot more complicated than we give him credit for. But within that complexity, however, I think that's where we've found, you know, really interesting solutions that people are actually employing. For example, with the Mission Asset Fund early on, when we were starting our work and trying to help people build and improve their financial security, you know, the conventional wisdom at that time was to say, well, let's do another financial education class. You know, let's do another brochure that might be glossy or maybe not glossy, might be Spanish on one side, English on the other side. You know, and that was the conventional wisdom, right? And I said, well, you know, I think there might be more to the solution than that. And so when we started looking at how people are actually navigating their own lives, then we started seeing a lot of wisdom there. And so one of the things that's very common, not just in immigrant communities here, but in really all over the world, is people actually do come together to lend and save money together. And so this is a practice that has been known. Many books have been written about this. Many stories have been done about this. But I think for us as practitioners in the policy world, we were sort of, you know, ignorant of it, right? Mm-hmm. And so what we did was to say, well, let's look at this incredible practice that's already common in the community, and trying to figure out how do we, you know, elevate that? How do we bring some real value or other value to it without trying to distort it, without trying to say, oh, you guys stop doing that because that's not how we do it here in America. You know, so that was the genesis of lending circles, really, to say, well, let's take what they're already doing with their money and figure out a way to formalize that so that we can get the financial system to actually recognize that. So that's the essence of, you know, of our program. But I think the bigger lesson there, you know, and I think that's something that we can take away, you know, in whatever issue area of our work is that we have to sort of step back for a second and really just accept the complexity of their lives for what it is. Mm-hmm. And not try to minimize it, not trying to simplify it so like it can fit on our charts or it can fit on our graphs, but to sort of say like, let's take that and then try to figure out what is the new ones that we can elevate so that we can design interventions, whether they're policy interventions or program interventions, to actually help that particular group of people. And I think that there's richness to it, there's possibility to it, so that, you know, at the end of the day, we have to, like, you know, again, leave people with a sense of hopefulness that their life or their children's lives can actually continue moving forward.
Right. Bill, so you work with Hope. Your work is centered in the Mississippi Delta, a place where you're trying to promote economic empowerment, some place that has a legacy of slavery, of Jim Crow, of lots of racial inequity. I'm wondering how you see that legacy manifesting and how you cope with it.
It's really interesting. A lot of what's been said here today resonates with the realities that I see in the Mississippi Delta, but I also often feel like we are in a parallel universe. You know, I moved to Mississippi from North Carolina in 94. In 95, I had a program officer from the Ford Foundation come down, and it was on the day that the Mississippi legislature finally ratified the 13th Amendment. So we were free. this was not in 1865, 1995. Interestingly, just last week, a federal judge ordered the desegregation of the Cleveland, Mississippi school districts, not 1954, Brown versus Board, but 2017. And so you see why it feels a bit like a parallel universe. Work in a region where, and there are 384 persistent poverty counties across the nation. These places had 20% poverty for at least three decades. But a quarter of those are in three of the states we work in, Mississippi, Arkansas, and Louisiana. In 35 of the 39 counties that are persistent poverty, that are majority, 39 of majority black the counties are majority black. 35 of those are persistent poverty counties. So those who are most vulnerable are still people of color. And if you think about any indicator of economic and social well-being, whether it's access to health care, decent schools, jobs, healthy food, those things are going to be lacking in those persistent poverty areas. And so it is a constant reminder that we are in a region that has not invested in certain segments of the population in an adequate way, and we are trying to balance the scales. One of our primary tools is through financial services. We have a credit union that is our primary tool. You heard about one of our members this morning. I don't know if I'm supposed to disclose that, but and it's interesting. The point was made that these aren't poor, and the folks in the financial diaries are not poor people, and that they have banking accounts, but 40% of our members didn't have an account before they joined the credit union. That's 40%. In Louisiana, almost a third of the population, black population, are unbanked, composed of 6% of the white population. And so those gaps are real. And so the ability of people to have the tools to address basic needs that many of us take for granted is not available. And so that's the context.
So building off that, Jose, I want to come back to you for a second and talk about some of the challenges that the people in your community face specifically. You work with a lot of immigrants, some of whom are citizens, some of whom are documented, some of who are not. What are the unique challenges that they face when it comes to trying to build wealth?
Right, so when we started, definitely not being banked was one of the big impediments to say, well, how are you going to help somebody build financial security when they don't even have the basic tools like a checking account or savings account, and even credit, or not having a credit score or credit report? It was one of those big barriers that we tackled. And that's still the case, because for new immigrants, whether you're undocumented or not, building a credit report is hard, and people are sort of like in this catch-22 that you need a credit score. I mean, you need a credit history to get a credit, but you need credit to, and so people kind of get stuck in that limbo there for a while. So our program, Lending Circles, was we built this so that we can actually help those individuals to kind of get into the financial mainstream by building their credit score. And that has been widely successful, not just in San Francisco, but we're working with partners, other nonprofits throughout the country. We have 54 other nonprofits that we're essentially franchising the program or licensing it, and so that they can implement it in different communities. But the thing that is happening now, and I want to sort of raise this up, because when our clients have come to us, they're not coming just with this idea like, I want to build my credit score. Now people come to us and ask us, you know, what's going to happen to their money if they get deported? You know, so this idea of being, you know, feeling that they can be deported at any given moment is such a real threat in their lives. You know, that they're not really thinking about credit scores anymore. You know, they're not thinking about checking accounts anymore. They're thinking about, hey, I have this pot of money. Where do I put it so that in case that happens, how can they manage that? Because it's not just an event for that particular individual. You know, it's an event for their family as a unit. I mean, I just read a report where, you know, a 14-year-old, 15-year-old had to learn how to pay rent, you know, for their family, just in case, you know, their one of his parents, you know, gets deported. And so that fear of that is a political thing, it's a legal thing, but it has real financial repercussions in their families, you know, financial lives, you know, even how precarious they may be, you know, but something like this actually, you know, kind of prevents them to thinking, you know, beyond just, you know, just the now. And so we have to, you know, again, we don't say, oh, well, I'm not going to talk to you guys unless you're going to talk about credit score. We have to, converse with them. We have to say, yeah, that is a real fear. That is a real, issue in that, not just in that person's life, but in the community. So that way we can, you know, build from that moment and help, you know, help them continue saving or building their financial lives. But we have to, you know, have those conversations in a real way, because that's in essence what they're thinking right now. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we're here talking about the convergence of race, inequality, economics at a really interesting time, at a time where in the days leading up to the election and the days following it, there's been a lot of focus on the economic plight of white men, on economic anxiety in white America. And there are some who would say that the thing that we should be doing when we're talking about economic inequality is talking about class inequality, not talking about race inequality, saying that poor white people, poor black people, poor Hispanic people have more in common than they do have differences. So I'm wondering, how do we address that, and how do we kind of get into the conversation and explain why it's important to have the convergence of all of these? Tom, I want to start with you.
Gee, thank you. It needs to be a very deep and robust conversation, and it's one that has been ongoing and needs to keep ongoing. But I think our reference to it and where we start has changed because of the last electoral cycle and the politics of the moment, at least, that's coming out of the nation's capital. My understanding is that we really need to focus on, it's not an either or, it's an and. It's race and economics. White working class, however you want to define that, and it's not a homogeneous group in a lot of ways. Nonetheless, the white working class has been feeling a lot of the pain that we've been talking about. The stalled mobility, the levels of inequality, the family living standards that have stagnated. While they see that, like other groups in American society sees it, I think in their mind, they also see it in a slightly different way. They see it as loss of status in comparison to other groups that they measure themselves against. And that's where the racial anxiety and the pandering of politicians and others and the media comes into play and exacerbates that. So it needs to be, you know, I'm afraid, because it's not an easy answer and it's not an easy challenge. It needs to be nuanced, at least in the way of acknowledging the pain and the suffering and the loss of status of the white working class, but it needs to be done in the context of what it's doing to the situations of people who work just like them, but whose ethnicity and race and maybe gender is different. I mean, it's an easy formula, but on the ground, it's tough.
Yeah, I agree, it is tough. I remember as a baby activist or organizer, way back in Chapel Hill when I was in school, we got into a debate with a Jewish colleague, fellow student. And, you know, my impression's worse than yours. My opinion's worse than yours. And, you know, that's, I was young and naive, but pain is pain. If you're oppressed, you're oppressed. And so, and I think divide and conquer is one of the, you know, we see it playing out today. in the political system. And I just don't think we're well served by that. Been working with colleagues from around the country. When I talked about the persistent poverty data, if you look at the map of persistent poverty counties across the country, yes, it is more concentrated in the Deep South and the Black Belt and the Delta than most places. But don't go to Appalachia and tell those folks they're not in pain. The Central Valley, the Texas-Mexico border, and we've actually done some things to work together with our colleagues in those areas. And under the previous administration, was able to find $500 million in unused resources in the USDA budget and target those toward investing in community facilities, schools, healthcare, critical services in these communities. After this morning's budget, you know, who knows where the future lies for that, and so many other critical issues that these communities face. But it's clear that working together, we were able to talk to folks in Wisconsin, rural Wisconsin. Paul Ryan's got a lot of poor white folks in his district, and so we've got to find that common ground and work together to push against this venom and divisiveness that we're seeing.
I want to add something to that. I mean, I think it's a great question, and I think fundamentally we need to get away from this notion of building policies or programs on this idea of only the most deserving can have access to this public, you know, good, right? And I think that idea that the most deserving kind of leads to this idea that we're going to pin, you know, our pain against each other just to see who's more painful. And I think as a society, we have to get to the point, it's like, you know what, we're all deserving. We all need help at some point of our lives or another. And when we need help, great. And when we don't need help, somebody else needs help. We are all deserving all of the time. And I think once we sort of, you know, agree within that value, then we can start talking about addressing all the inequalities, all the policies, so that we can all have, you know, equal opportunity. Because I think, you know, this is part of, you know, accepting the complexities of life without trying to minimize them or simplify them so that they can fit into this idea that, you know, we're going to be more oppressed than you, and thus we need more help. But I think we need to kind of get away from that altogether.
I do think, though, we need to make sure we don't ignore the fact, as you pointed out, as the data make very clear, some segments of the population are in much worse straits than others. In Mississippi, over half of the kids less than 19 are majority black. And disproportionately, those folks do not have schools that they need, health care they need, jobs, healthy food, you name it. And so if we're not intentional about addressing the needs of those who need it most, then we all lose. You know, who's going to, you know, regardless of what you want your tax revenues used for, if nobody's generating, if you don't have a productive society, then we all are going to lose. And so we've got to stop ignoring the fact that even though someone may not look like you or they may not be in your district, then they don't deserve the kind of things that we all take for granted.
So this is a beginning of a great conversation. It's actually not the beginning. I think we've been involved in this for a long period. I think part of my understanding of our historical experience, I think there's a couple of really important lessons here. One is that the race, ethnicity, class cards tend to be played around things like entitlement, about what policy is doing for X group or not. At least that's the narrative and that's the claim. But I think now we've just entered the flip side of that, where something really important is being taken away from people, their health care. And it's being taken not on a racial or an ethnic basis. It's being taken from large gloms and groups of families and communities. And this is the moment for our community-based organizations and others to spin a narrative and to talk about that in a way that pulls communities together based around, unfortunately, what's about to be taken away from them. And I think that's the beginning, perhaps the beginning of a certain alliance and initiative that can be built.
I want to pivot for a second and talk a little bit about mobility. You know, as somebody who reports on this a lot, I know that people think there's a lot more economic mobility built into the U.S. system than data actually proves out. Bill, I know one of the things that you work on is helping African American folks in your region own businesses, start businesses, get business loans. That has proven to theoretically be a great way for people to build wealth. I'm wondering, what are some of the lessons you've learned and what are some of the experiences you've had trying to kind of empower folks in the Delta in that way?
You know, it's interesting. Before you can get to, you know, the most successful business owners are people who've had family members who have been business owners. If I can call my cousin Jose, who's my accountant, and help him, and he'll help me navigate some of the financial management issues I'm dealing with, then I'm going to be more successful as an entrepreneur. Well, people who have not had that opportunity are less likely to be successful. And so you start from a negative place with many African-American business owner, entrepreneurs, and still, though, the primary source of wealth for assets for most Americans is their home. And so we really are very focused on multiple ways to build wealth, where we have entrepreneurs, where we can finance them and help them be successful and not get them in trouble, because sometimes the best thing you can tell someone who wants to be in business is that you're not quite ready yet, and here are some things you need to do to get there, and we do that. That's what distinguishes a community development financial institution from a traditional bank. You've got to start from where people are, and so helping them to build wealth, whether it's through savings, getting them in the banks, and into a financial account. As I said, 40% of our members did not have an account before they joined the credit union. Almost 80% of our mortgages are to first-time homebuyers. Over 80% of them are to African Americans. We work with distressed communities across the region, but disproportionately, the folks who come through our door are people of color. And so they come in and they get a mortgage, and it's really fascinating the impact that has on one's lives. They talk about how the kids do better in school now that they're a homeowner. They have more recreational opportunities, so they're healthier. They're more productive individuals. They feel like they're in a safer neighborhood, and so those benefits start to accrue. And then when you have when you build equity in your home, then you can use that to find the equity to finance a small business, or to send a kid to school, or to avoid that debt trap, you know, when the payday lenders that have replaced so many financial institutions in these communities come knocking on your door. Interestingly, since the recession, we've grown, I think, over 90% of the 2,000 plus bank branches across the country that have closed were in low-income census tracts. We're a bit masochistic. We've gone from 7 to 30 something branches since the recession, and most of those are in persistent poverty counties. Interestingly, we took over a cluster in the heart of Mississippi Delta, and in less than a year, we'd already tripled the number of accounts and the number of loans at the bank that the previous bank that had been there for decades. And so it's really fascinating what people can do when they have the tools. Unfortunately, too many do not have the tools.
When we talk about people having the tools, Jose, I want to come to you and talk about how you guys try and use credit and building credit and credit history to create mobility.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, to us, the credit report is sort of like a U.S. passport, that without that, you really can't go to another country. So without that credit report, you know, people can't get, you know, apartments, they can't get jobs, you know, they can't get that loan. And so that credit report, you know, has become in our society, you know, this really invaluable tool. So without that, you know, you really can't do much of anything. So for immigrants, new immigrants, you know, that's one of those impediments that we need to help them overcome. And so what we've seen is that, you know, just by virtue of participating in our Lending Circle program, that, you know, people have been able to increase their credit scores by like 168 points. I mean, like about a third of our clients start with zero, or they're completely invisible to the credit system. But after, you know, 10 months of reporting payment information, and they go from zero to 600 or 650, and now they become, you know, visible into the credit system. And then with that, now they can apply, you know, to your fine institutions and get loans and buy cars and so forth. So now they have the you know, they have their you know, a world of opportunities for them open up, in a sense, without us necessarily being the ones to actually make those loans for them, right? And so, in a sense, you know, we're, you know, expanding the pool of eligible borrowers for, you know, banks and credit unions to work with them. And that sense of empowerment, you know, we've seen it in our clients by, you know, walking with a little spring in their step after they kind of, you know, get recognized by the, you know, with a credit from with a credit score. You know, they feel recognized. They feel like they have the actual key to do something. And it is also really important for us to say we didn't give this to you as a form of a charity or as a form of like, oh, pobrecitos, we're going to help you here. No, it's like, you know, we took this incredible practice that's already happening in our community that is actually quite phenomenal when you think about people coming together, lending and saving money together, just by the sheer trust, the sheer word. It's like the social trust that is embedded there is just phenomenal, right? And so us, we didn't treat them, you know, less than. You know, we actually treat them with a high degree of dignity and say, like, this is phenomenal. We just sort of elevated it so that the rest of the world can recognize that. And that's really important because the way you provide something is really key, you know, because we didn't want it to diminish them in any way. And so they walk with a spring in their step so that they can say, you know what, I'm going to invest in, you know, either taking their, what I call their nano businesses. They're not even small businesses, they're like nano. And they go from nano to micro, and then from micro to small. And then that to us, that they made it big time. But it's sort of like, how do you do that in their trajectory, in their, you know, whatever makes sense for them, right? And so, but again, the way of articulating and providing that intervention is really important, and that's something that we need to be mindful when we think about, you know, developing, you know, programs and also policies that is not about diminishing them. It's not about making sure that show me how poor you are before I actually help you. You know, and that's the case for a lot of our, you know, programs, like in food stamps, or where they have to sort of revalidate your, you know, income and everything. Right? It's like, you know what? Why don't we, you know, loosen up? Of course, not with the current administration, not going to happen. But I think as society, we need to sort of think, you know, more expand in like that. So that is not about diminishing people, you know, just because they need help. I think we all need help. All, you know, and we need to develop programs that can uplift our humanness.
Bill, I know you want to quickly weigh in.
No, just this point about dignity. I think it made me think about a gentleman in Drew, Mississippi, small town, less than 2,000 people. Mr. Franklin every day walks over a mile to our branch. He withdraws $9. $9 every day. He tries to ration out his disability check to make it last over the month. And he, when he goes, he comes in there and he makes up his draw. And he spends a lot of time in the branch interacting with our staff, who calls him Mr. Franklin, who welcomes him, who makes him feel respected. Yeah. I told this story last year when Vice President Biden was here. We had a woman who on her 100th birthday opened her first account with the money that she was given. This is, you should not have to wait a century. An African-American woman in the Mississippi Delta or anywhere should not have to wait a century before she can go into a federally insured financial institution and feel like she's treated with respect.
Tom, quickly, I want to come back to you because I think that there's this narrative in America about bootstrapping and being self-made and building your own wealth and creating your own mobility. And you know, we see it all the time from people saying, I paid off 100 grand in student loans in 2 years, and then you find out, you know, their parents are millionaires and they were staying in a condo for free. And I find it really frustrating. So I want you to just give us a quick top line on the role of inheritance in building wealth and mobility.
Sure, thank you again. Very few families in American society, first of all, inherit large pots of money. It's about 2 in 4 American families. We were looking at a 30-year nationally representative database. About 2 in 4 American families inherit 10,000 or more. And by inherit, I mean not just at the passing of a parent or grandparent, but money that's passed along, like for a down payment on a house, which is really critical, helping to pay for a college education. Now, 2 in 4, that's national. About 1 in 10 African-Americans and a little over half of whites. I don't have the data on Latinos at the top of my head. I apologize for that at the moment. So you see right away a 4 to 5 to 1 inheritance differential, white-black. And then when we ask the question, all right, of that 10% of African Americans that actually do inherit, how much do they inherit? And the answer to that is they inherit $30,000 less than what the average white family does. So you have the layering, the sedimentation, the accumulation of that kind of inequality laid on. Let me tell, if I have time, at least two quick stories. Maybe we'll get to a third. We interviewed one family in St. Louis who were conducting garage sales because they wanted to move. They wanted their kid in a better school district. They actually wanted to get out of a community that was becoming too diverse for their own tastes. They wanted to move further down the Mississippi River. And they kept holding these garage sales. So what were they doing? They were trying to sell the same things over and over again, right? The things they didn't want anymore. And after a few Sundays, that kind of wears out and nothing happens. So they're sitting at dinner with her mother one night, and they're talking about their vision of wanting to move down the Mississippi River, a better community, a better school, better community, safer, and all of that was important to them. And they've run into this roadblock of money. The mother says, stop, reaches into her pocketbook and writes a $30,000 check. I all wish we had mothers like that. I really do. But later in that interview, when we asked them to catalog their wealth and assets, and we asked them to tell us the story of how you bought that home, you know, that $30,000 check was like that river in Egypt, denial. It was not in their consciousness at all. And instead, they flipped the American notion of deservedness right in its head and said, we deserved it because we kept holding garage sales. Now, a lot of us hold garage sales. All right, you see the point. Second quick example. Also a St. Louis family. Family is very wealthy. Her parents and grandparents are very wealthy. A St. Louis establishment from way back. The family income was $70,000. Their two kids were in private school. They're living in a very upscale, swanky community. And I'm asking, you know, as the interviewer, in my head, not her yet, there's something in this picture that doesn't add up. Until we get to the question of, have you ever gotten something from your parents? It was over $1 million. And when the other parent passed away, there was a lot more money to be passed along. So I'm asking her then, at that point in the second interview, we ask her, how would your life have changed if you didn't have that money? Can you imagine that? And she mulls it over, and she talks about, well, my kids wouldn't be in private school, I wouldn't be able to have the part-time job, my husband would have to look for a real job, we wouldn't be living in this community. It's unimaginable, were her words. Unimaginable, in her words. And I then asked her kind of a follow-up question. And I asked her, what would your kids' life be like? And he had talked about one of the children having a learning disability that was undocumented, but it got the son into special schools, special college, as it turned out. And again, it's unimaginable. Life could not have happened that way. And that's part of the mindset that goes with that. It's partial denial. It's partial flipping it on its head. And then finally, when I asked her about where she would be in 10 years and where the family would be, I don't want to open the book, but I'm going to remember the quote pretty carefully. She said, we're going to be in a good place because we make good financial decisions. That's the way we roll. All right. And I'm going. All right, stay cool. Stay cool.
You want to jump in a little on this?
Yeah.
I completely thanks for that, because I think that's part of your work, and in the whole conversation about the racial wealth gap is really saying that it's not about those individual faults. It is the characteristics of certain groups fall for not saving enough, not working enough, or something, right? That is something a lot more systemic, and I think there's a lot of wisdom and for us to sort of uphold that. But I also think that we need to have a much more nuanced and contextualized analysis about what's happening, about generational wealth, particularly when it comes to the Latino community. Because I was doing some analysis and I found that about 50% of Latino adults in 2012 were first generation Americans. 50% were immigrants. 50% of Latino adults were immigrants. 75 were either first generation or second generation. Second generation meaning that they were at least had one parent that was an immigrant. So when you talk about this, the wealth of this community, that is 75% of them are either first or second generation, you know, the time factor is just not there, you know, to accumulate and much less to pass down, right? So I think, you know, but there's a lot more nuance to be had about that in terms of how different, you know, different communities and nationalities kind of came in and, you know, and made themselves part of America. Because, you know, different groups were, you know, either welcomed or some were not welcomed, or some were giving, you know, direct amnesty right away, and some of them were not. Some of them were given some aid, some of them were not. So you have like different sort of groups of individuals kind of coming in and integrating themselves into America in different sort of, you know, methods. So the richness there, I think, is something that we have to sort of, again, acknowledge and embrace and not minimize, because I think we can learn a lot about their either their strategies, the way they sort of, you know, coped with how they became part of America. And I think that's really where I think we can kind of come up with good ideas of developing solutions, you know, policy solutions to the issue of the wealth gap.
Tom, brief final thought. All right.
So the data tell actually two different one-way streets that aren't running in parallel. White families transmit intergenerational resources to their children and their adult children. Almost overwhelmingly so. In fact, it's almost a joke if you ask a 20, 30-year-old, do you help others? And interviewees have laughed at that question, literally. However, the data tell us that among both Latino and African American communities, it's their adult children that's helping out older generations.
That's true.
The resources and the money is going elsewhere.
Yeah.
And it looks like wealth depletion, but it's really very fundamental to their family stability and their community stability.
Yeah. That's right. Gentlemen, we could talk about this all day. Thank you so much, and thank you to our audience.